my opening address, I would just like to acknowledge sort of two groups of people. First, our newest Anciens that are attending for their very first Anciens seminar, and they're from Senior Course 134, which just graduated. So three Italian colleagues, Roberto, and Antonio. I'm just going to do your first names. So right here. And if I may, our most mature Anciens from Senior Course 57, Ambassador Peter Murphy from the United States and Minister Everard Voss from Germany. Where are you? Ah, there we go. And welcome everybody in between. So distinguished members of the Diplomatic Corps, Anciens, ladies and gentlemen, it's certainly my pleasure to welcome you to the 66th Annual Anciens Seminar here at the NATO Defense College in beautiful Rome. Many of you also attended last night's reception, which I thought was tremendous, and were able to strengthen the bonds and the networks and the friendships that you've cultivated during your time here at the college. Today, for the Anciens Seminar of 2019, we are gathered in this auditorium more than 97 Anciens, 75 course members from senior course, from 30 in the senior course, of which there are 30 nations represented. 32 course members from 17 nations are attending the NATO Regional Cooperation Course, of which we are celebrating their 10th anniversary this year. And I think Ambassador Mini Toruso is probably very proud of that fact. And as well as several guests and staff of the NATO Defense College. For the record, the Anciens here today also represent 23 nations. This speaks directly to the multinational dimension of the NATO Defense College. It also speaks to the volume of the significant impacts the college has on its valued course members, as well as the outreach potential that you each represent. May I extend a special welcome to our panelists this morning. Ambassador Mini Toruso, President of the NATO Defense College Foundation. Mr. Diego Palmer of the United States, Special Advisor for Net Assessment in the Defense Policy and Planning Division. And Dr. Jan Kasapoglu, Director of Defense Research Program at the Istanbul-based think tank EDEM and IPC. I'm not going to be able to say this correctly. Thank you, fellow at the German Research Institute. But I must also state that he was our very first Eisenhower Fellow. So welcome back to the college. And our panel moderator will be Dr. Terry Tardy from the Director of Research Division here at the NDC. And finally, I have the extreme honor of welcoming this year's keynote speaker, Professor Jamie Shea of the UK. It is a great honor for me as Commandant to host representatives from so many countries. I am grateful for your support and interest and continued interest in the NATO Defense College activities and projects. As you know, the Anciens Seminar is organized only once per year in accordance with the principles and goals of the Association's Constitution. We're really here to preserve and develop the bonds of friendship that were forged while you were members of the NATO Defense College. We're also here to enable the study, the Anciens to study and be informed more about the Alliance and more recent activities, and to encourage information exchange and academic interaction. We're really here also to provide an influential and informative body of opinion to help support the Alliance. The Anciens Association today numbers over 9,000 members. And that's enough, that's really enough about the Anciens Association for now, and let me move on to the subject matter of the distinguished guests before us. This year's theme for the conference is Looking Forward, NATO's Response to Future Challenges, which promises to be both informative and stimulating. I encourage you strongly to actively participate and to make the most of the privilege that we have today with these outstanding speakers. It is now my extreme pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Professor Jamie Shea. Professor Shea is a professor of strategy and security of the Strategy and Security Institute, University of Exeter in the UK, and a member of the group of strategic advisors of the NATO Special Operations Force Command at SHAPE. Prior to that, he was an international public servant and a member of the international staff of NATO for 38 years, where amongst key appointments he held the Director of Policy Planning in the Private Office of the Secretary General, Deputy Assistant, you have to sit down for a minute, there's quite a few accolades here, Deputy Assistant Secretary General for External Relations, Public Diplomacy Division, Director of Information and Press, Assistant to the Secretary General of NATO for Special Projects, and participated in the design and conduct of the NATO Crisis Management Exercise. Academic institutions to which he is associated include the Collège d'Europe in Bruges, the University of Sussex, the American University in Washington, the University of Caen, and of course the University of Exeter. Professor Shea is a senior transatlantic fellow of the German Marshall Fund of the United States and a senior fellow at the London School of Economics. He also contributed to numerous papers, lectures, and conferences on NATO and European security affairs and on public diplomacy, political communication, and many other areas of contemporary international relations. Professor Shea is also active as a member of many associations, the Advisory Board on the Security and Defense Programs at Chatham House, the Policy Council at the World Economic Forum in Geneva, the Security and Defense Agenda, Brussels and Friends of Europe, the Danish Defense College in Copenhagen, the Académie Diplomatique Nationale à Paris, and he is currently a senior advisor at the European Policy Center and a senior fellow at the Friends of Europe. Professor Shea is a recipient of the Golden Eagle Medal of the Republic of Albania and the Lyndon Medal of the Czech Republic. He is a European Communicator of the Year in 1999, and he was awarded the International Prize for Human Rights of the AEB University in Kosovo in 2016. And he is also a recipient of the NATO Medal for Meritorious Service. On this, and following an impressive list of accomplishments, Professor Shea, it is indeed my pleasure and honor to welcome you to the NATO Defense College and for your keynote address. The floor is yours, sir.
Dear General, and why I was never in the office at NATO headquarters during those 38 years. The only thing that you left off was the only thing which is remotely memorable about my career so far is that in 1999, the French magazine Elle voted me as the sixth sexiest man in the universe. I was, of course, extremely disappointed to only come in at number six, but there you go. Life doesn't always go the way you want it to. No, thank you. Thanks for the generous introduction. Thank you for the invitation. When you retire from an organization, you and are put out to grass as an ancient warhorse, and I'm more ancien than many of the anciens in the audience this morning, you always feel they're never going to invite me back. I shall be forgotten. But I'm really delighted that the NDC isn't one of those institutions. Thank you for keeping me on your radar screen. I love so much the times I came here throughout my NATO career to participate in debates, to give presentations. I always found it rewarding. People say, the NDC is the great institution because it's in Rome, but even if it were in Wolverhampton, I personally would still want to come, because for me, it's not just about Rome, it's about this place, and so I feel as if I'm sort of almost back home. So thank you for not forgetting about me. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when you retire, the great thing is that you can say whatever you like. Finally, you are liberated to express your views, but of course, nobody wants to listen any longer, or is remotely interested, because they no longer see you as representing the institution. But I'm very pleased today, nonetheless, to be able to give you my take on NATO's future challenges. Of course, it's going to be a personal view. What else can it be? And when Edmund Burke, at the time of the French Revolution, wrote his famous Reflections on the Revolution in France, he sent a copy to the Prime Minister, Pitt the Younger, and Pitt wrote back saying, "It's a rhapsody in which there is much to be admired, but absolutely nothing to agree with." And maybe you'll consider my speech today to be similar. I'm going to throw out my own personal take. You agree or disagree, but hopefully at least you will agree that I've identified the major questions that NATO faces, if I haven't provided all of the answers. Let's start with this year. It's the 70th anniversary year of NATO. To be frank, very few people might have predicted back in 1949 that NATO would have lasted for 70 years. Those of you who know NATO's anxious birth will remember that the Americans at the time did see it largely as a short-term arrangement, which would provide military assistance to Europe and reassurance for about 10 years. That was the view that was first considered for the length of the treaty, just 10 years, after which time Europe would put its house back in order, stand on its own two feet, and US support would no longer be necessary. A kind of military Marshall Plan to go, obviously, with the economic Marshall Plan. And when the treaty was signed, the State Department band was called into service and decided rather humorously to play two songs from Porgy and Bess by George Gershwin, "I've Got Plenty of Nothing" and "It Ain't Necessarily So," which was hardly a massive vote of confidence. And academic research since has looked at alliances over the last 500 years or so. The Brookings Institution did a big study a few years back and looked at 63 different alliances, and the average age was 15 years only. The longest lasted for 40 years. NATO has done almost double that. So clearly there's something different about NATO than the traditional type of alliance. So the two big questions, I think, really, for my introduction today is, why has NATO lasted so long? And will it last for another 70 years on the basis of what has kept it together up to now? So why has it lasted so long? Well, there's no single answer, but I would sort of look at things like the US hegemon has been willing to extend security and defense to its European allies for 70 years. Not without grumbling. I was looking at, for example, some of the speeches of John F. Kennedy the other day, and he was almost as colorful and as assertive on the burden-sharing issue, the need for the Europeans to do more, as Donald Trump. Sometimes, you know, closing your eyes and thinking, you know, what was said by Kennedy, what was said by Trump, wasn't so easy to distinguish. So the US has quite rightly grumbled along the way at the risks that this might entail. Henry Kissinger once questioned nuclear deterrence in the sense that he wasn't certain that the US president would really be prepared to provide that in a crisis. So yes, there have been questions, there have been doubts. The burden-sharing debate has been there from the beginning. But by and large, the US has concluded that NATO produced more good than harm. It was in its interest, a comparative advantage, to be engaged, and that the price of defending Europe was offset by many other advantages, having good allies who would support the United States in global foreign policy ventures, Afghanistan, of course, being perhaps the most recent, but there were many others, having bases and infrastructure in Europe that was helpful for the US protection of power elsewhere, of course, and having a group of allies who, with the United States, were best suited to maintain a multilateral, international, rules-based liberal order, which ultimately benefited the United States in the long run. The Europeans were largely happy to accept that form of protection, even though from the late 1950s onwards, they certainly have had the GDP and the population to arguably defend themselves without so much United States assistance. But they've chosen not to do so, to rely upon US protection, knowing that that protection would be at an affordable cost to themselves and would be largely benign. A famous Norwegian academic, Geir Lundstad, spoke back in the 60s of empire by invitation, that the United States was invited in by the Europeans to do that. So there was a willing provider and a willing recipient. I think the third reason is because allies over the years have largely seen NATO as the best insurance policy on the market, that the NATO collectivity has provided a degree of security that other arrangements, coalitions of the willing, unilateralism, regional groupings, even a European Defence and Security Union would not be able to provide. Of course, that is one of the things that we have to consider these days. Do allies still consider NATO to be the best insurance policy on the market? Is the United States seeing it in the same way? When Poland, for example, goes directly to Washington and offers to pay 2 billion euros for what we now call Fort Trump, a greater bilateral sort of US engagement with infrastructure, with extra forces permanently based in Poland, is that a form of saying that NATO now is no longer adequate and we need therefore to take our extra insurance policy by going directly to the United States? When Turkey, and of course this is the big issue at the moment, obviously it feels that it has to deal with issues unilaterally or on its southern border outside the NATO framework. Again, is that a feeling that NATO no longer provides all of the security that it feels that it needs? When Macron and Merkel speak publicly that the days when Europe could rely on the United States for its security are over, and even evoke a European army, is that also questioning the sufficiency of NATO as one single collective insurance policy which everybody pays into because it alone provides the benefits? Another reason was NATO's ability to adapt to change. Remarkably, being able quickly to reinvent itself when the security environment changed, as it did with the end of the Cold War, when it was out of area or out of business, you remember that slogan, and of course we engaged in the Balkans and later on in Afghanistan and elsewhere. Finally, I would argue socialization of defense. I remember very well back in the 1980s, shortly after I joined NATO, Spain suffered a military coup or a near military coup. The bullet holes can still be seen in the ceiling of the chamber of the Cortes. And afterwards, I was speaking to a Spanish diplomat, and he said, yes, Jamie, NATO's great for us because all of these generals we sent to Brussels to shape, where they will spend their time in cocktail parties and in NATO meetings, they will be thoroughly socialized and denationalized, and we won't face any particular danger internally again. And it was a bit of a joke, but there was some truth in it, like all good jokes. NATO has got the allies into the habit of regarding security like as a social collective enterprise that they can do together, that they don't have to do alone. And after the Cold War, when we wondered if NATO's existential threat had gone away and therefore NATO's raison d'etre had gone away, this idea that we don't want to go back to renationalizing defense, we don't want to go back to having to bear the burden alone of planning for our security against multiple threats on multiple borders, this collective form of endeavor has served us very well in maintaining the peace. I think that was a key reason why nobody was questioning, although they can withdraw from the Washington Treaty by simply giving 1 year's notice if they want to, but nobody was questioning NATO's raison d'etre. But I would also say, before I turn to the future, that NATO survived 70 years because it was relatively lucky. Relatively lucky. Napoleon once said, may I please have lucky generals? And in a way, you know, NATO's call has been answered. I mean, the Soviet Union was formidable but was conservative, largely status quo oriented, largely seeking to expand its influence outside Europe during the Cold War period rather than inside Europe. It was willing, the Soviet Union, to be largely predictable in its behavior. It was largely penetrable by our intelligence services in trying to work out where it was going. It was willing to be entangled or tied down through multiple arms control agreements. in the nuclear area, in conventional area, in terms of transparency talks and stability talks, and so on. And deterrence vis-a-vis the Soviet Union proved to be enough. It was never necessary to fight it. And Article 5 vis-a-vis the Soviet Union never had to be seriously tested. It was finally invoked against a terrorist threat from the Middle East after 9/11. So we were sort of lucky in a kind of way with the Soviet Union as our adversary. It could have been a lot worse. Secondly, NATO was lucky in that through much of its history, it was one thing in one place at one time. One thing in one place at one time. I remember when I first joined NATO, the map on my office wall was at a Fulda Gap. The future of the world would play out in the 60 kilometers on the inner German border on the Fulda Gap. And if we could focus all of our resources and intelligence and plug that, then everything would be right in East-West relations more generally. And then that map came down and up went the map of the Yugoslavia. Do you remember Yugoslavia? For 10 years we engaged there, but it wasn't just about Yugoslavia. It was about the New World Order. It was about the responsibility to protect. It was about upholding international justice and prosecuting for the first time successfully for war crimes and genocide and massive abuses of human rights. It was a laboratory where the military were going to be social workers and rebuild states and do reconciliation and for the first time work with the United Nations and the European Union and the OSCE in a comprehensive approach. So Yugoslavia was the microcosm that would lead to the macrocosm. Get it right there and the rest of the world would be largely a peaceful place. Look at Tony Blair's speech in May 1999 at the Chicago Global Affairs Council to get a flavor of that kind of optimism. So in other words, we had this sort of view that one single security challenge held the key to the rest of the world. Get it right there, and everything would sort of fall nicely into place. Similarly with Afghanistan. You remember the initial optimism about Afghanistan, and it wasn't just about Afghanistan. It was about the liberation of women in Muslim communities. It was about Muslim and Arab democracy. It was about building bridges over the supposed clash of civilizations. It was about killing the beast of jihadist and fundamentalist extremism. But take, for example, an article in the Washington Post that came out just last year when Raqqa fell. And the headline was, "The good news, Raqqa has fallen. The bad news, now we can focus on the 26 other conflicts in Syria that could be just as bad as ISIS, but which, of course, we have neglected." And, of course, we see those conflicts now exploding very much in what's going on at the moment. So the idea that there was one single issue, which would, if you like, if we got it right, determine the rest of the world, has gone. The problem today is that all of the problems are interconnected and all of the solutions are disconnected. David Petraeus said a few years back that if we could get the Arab-Palestinian Israeli dispute solved, there would be peace in the Middle East. It would be very nice to have the Arab-Israeli dispute solved, ladies and gentlemen, but nobody thinks for one minute that that would have much effect on all of the other issues that we are facing. So problems have now not been aggregated, but disaggregated. And therefore, where do you start? Which solution, which problem do you look at first in the hope that it will help you solve the other solutions? What are our priorities? That has become very difficult indeed. NATO can no longer have the luxury of dealing with one issue in one place at one time. And of course, that was a luxury, right? We had a lot of time to get it right. We could make mistakes in the Balkans and Afghanistan and correct them. You know, we could improve our intelligence and so on. You know, we had lots of notice that we were going to deploy there. So we had months to get our forces ready and prepare send them. We also had pretty weak adversaries for much of this period. The Milosevic's, the Gaddafi's, the Somali pirates of this world, the Saddam Hussein's were irritating, but they were not formidable existential adversaries, and they could be removed with comparatively minor use of force. They were technologically backward. They had very little global influence. They had few friends in the world. They were isolated, and they lived in largely collapsing societies. Will we have the luxury of easy adversaries like those guys in the future? I think you know the answer to the question as I answer it. And finally, we had an international system that was relatively stable. Most of the great powers were not revisionist. Think of today. Nearly all great powers today are revisionist. The European Union is arguably the one status quo power in the world that is happy, by and large, with the multilateral system as it is and wants to preserve it. Everybody else thinks they're getting a very raw deal, they're being cheated, and they would like to revise and change that deal, and they're willing to take risks to achieve that goal. Bipolarity, clear spheres of influence, largely status quo, and a number of norms, international norms, arms control treaties, the nuclear proliferation treaty, and so on, which people were generally willing to follow. Anyway, you get where I'm coming to. We were lucky in the last 70 years. NATO survived, yes, through its own skill, adaptation, but we were lucky in the sense of the pressures or the demands that the international environment were placing on us. Now look at today. Where are the norms? They're collapsing around us. We now have a free-for-all when large number of new things like emerging technologies, biotechnology, automated weapon systems, robotization of the battlefield, space offensive weapon systems, offensive cyber, there are no norms and rules of the road, and there are not likely to be any soon. The idea of power is back in terms of out-muscling your opponent to dictate outcomes. We now have multiple domains. I was lucky. I only had to deal with three domains for most of my NATO career, land, sea, and air. Now we have another three. We have the information space. We have space, where NATO will declare space as a domain of operations at the summit in just a few days' time. And we have cyberspace. And, of course, figuring out which of those spaces is going to be decisive in modern war and how you have a dominance in all six and how you correlate those spaces to be able to engineer the best impact of one on the other is a key challenge. And of course, competition is less dangerous in some of those spaces, such as cyber or the information space, so it is pursued more vigorously as a result, which means that we've gone from a situation where there's either peace or war to a perpetual grey area where some form of warfare at some kind of level is going on every day of the week. We now have multiple adversaries. You know, the old NATO was one adversary. Now, you could argue that we've had ISIS, we've had dictators in the Balkans in recent years, we have Russia as a competitor, of course, since 2014, and the annexation of Crimea. NATO is looking at China, if not as an adversary, at least as a potential competitor, but as something that has to be factored in. The anti-ISIS coalition, Iran, at least indirectly, as the source of the initial NATO missile defense system in Europe. And, you know, so which of those adversaries is the most important? Are we putting our priorities on the right adversary, short term, long term? And we have multiple dependencies. Our economic strength doesn't any longer come from the same place that provides the security. China could be a more important economic partner for Europe in the 21st century than the United States. With the dependence on Chinese technology, and when the crisis comes calling, which way do you go? And for example, in my country, the United Kingdom, in the previous May government, we had this very interesting moment where Gavin Williamson, who was the Defence Secretary at the time, announced that the new UK aircraft carrier, the QE2, once it finished its sea trials, would deploy to the South China Sea. Upset the trade minister, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Philip Hammond, who the next day was due to lead a trade delegation, Global Britain, Brexit, to Beijing, which was cancelled as the Chinese expressed their displeasure at the announcement by the Defence Secretary that he would join the United States with the new aircraft carrier to pursue freedom of navigation. It's just one little vignette. I could name, if I had the time, I could quote many others, of where multiple dependencies, the reliance on multiple different outside actors for key technologies, for key trade deals, for key infrastructure, for key loans, is going to obviously complicate the management of security in any major crisis. So what are the consequences for NATO? Well, the first thing is we now have to deal with three strategic fronts. For the first time, there's strategic front east, Strategic Front South and Strategic Front Homeland, which is new for NATO. That is difficult enough, right? To have three different fronts that you have to keep on your radar screen, like looking at sort of three TVs all the time. But the complicating factor here is that the instruments that you need to deal with Strategic Front East, like tanks and artillery and multiple locket launchers and air defense and, you know, highly combat-ready large formations, mass, or the ability to apply mass quickly through mobility and reinforcement, doesn't get you very far in the south, right? When you need good political relations, ties with NGOs and the European Union, conversation with the World Bank on development, talking to educationalists about how you train, as you do here in the NATO Defence College, next generation of local partners and officers. No, it's a different business model entirely. And then let's look at Strategic Front Homeland Defence. In my last week at NATO, I remember going to a meeting with the nuclear planning staff on Monday, where there were eight people in military uniform, all of my generation, who had all been doing nuclear deterrence since kindergarten, who all spoke the same language. I had the impression they knew each other better than they knew their wives or their children. It was a community that had been working together for a generation, and that's all we needed to do nuclear deterrence. I went on the last day to a cyber conference at NATO, where 90% of the participants were outside NATO headquarters. They came from business, they came from the intelligence services, they came from the police, they came from the federal emergency services, and we had the hackers. The benign hackers with their black T-shirts, with their long hair, with their earrings and their crosses. And you looked at them, mostly unshaven, and you looked at them and you thought, my God, are they really on my side? How do I know? What are they going to do if I upset them? They can sort of destroy me in 5 minutes in a way that the Soviet Union was never able. But you get what I'm getting at. You got this sense of, my God, you know, here on this new issue, we need a totally different community, and what NATO has to do is persuade these people to be willing to cooperate with us, and what do we do to incentivize them to do that? So the problem I see today is that we have three fronts with three different networks, three different, if you like, casts of characters. It's almost like three plays in one. Imagine you're at the London Theatre, where you start with Shakespeare, and then half time the set changes and you do Pirandello, right? Or Samuel Beckett. A completely different sort of view of the world, a different set of characters, a different decor, and you have to be able smoothly to transition from one to the other where the crisis would come from. And so my sense is that's where we really are going to be. So where do I see the challenges ahead? Well, building on what I've just said, I think the first thing is NATO in the 21st century is going to have much more connectivity and a much greater ability to analyze problems before rushing into solutions. Let me just illustrate this, if I may, by just a few examples, because I think examples are much better than theories. I went to Lloyd's of London a few years ago with Jaap de Hoop Scheffer, the Secretary General of NATO, my dear boss at the time, and we went to speak to Lloyd's, the big shipping organization, about NATO's role on piracy. The Secretary General told them about all of the good things that NATO naval forces were doing in the Gulf of Aden and the money we were spending. And I think naturally he expect these insurance agents to thank him. But one got his calculator out and said, well, Secretary General, you know, how much are you spending? 8 billion euros a year. How many pirate ships are you intercepting? You know, how many ships are you using? How many ships are going through the Gulf of Aden every year? And he did a calculation. He said, this is 0.25 risk. We don't need you. What he meant was that for us, this is still, from in our community, an acceptable level of risk vis-a-vis losses in terms of insurance premiums. It's an extreme example, but what it made me realize is that obviously, when one looks at these sort of issues, putting in the military as the instantaneous solution, often very expensive, is not necessarily the best way to go, or what the community out there dealing with these issues naturally expects. I mean, another example, for example, occurred during Kosovo in 1999, where we were bombing Serb TV relay stations to put Serb TV off the air because we felt rightly that it was inciting violence. And I remember a meeting one day where we were looking at the success rate, which was pretty low. The relays were rebuilt almost immediately. It was like mowing the grass. And there was a NATO ambassador at the meeting. I won't give his name, but he said, anybody phoned up UTELSAT? What the heck's UTELSAT? Yeah, UTELSAT in Paris, you know, that does the satellite transmission. Why don't you give them a call? All right. So we phoned up UTELSAT. We described the problem. They said, oh, no problem. Switch. That was it. Transmission was blocked. No need to do any expensive bombing any longer. Third example. In my final years at NATO, I dealt a lot with improvised explosive devices. You know, the roadside bombs that were very dangerous to our troops in Afghanistan. You remember 57 varieties like Heinz Soup, only cost $5 to $10 to make, put in the ground at night. You pull them out during the day, and at night, back in they go. Difficult, therefore, to detect. And we were spending billions. Many of you remember this. You dealt with it too. On helicopters, on heavy vehicles, on route clearance, on protective gear for the soldiers. The Pentagon produced 25,000 MRAPs, you know, mine-resistant armored personnel carriers to help their troops. We had the best hospitals in the world in Afghanistan, but we had the problem that the bang was the worst point for us, because the bang meant that the explosion went off, the troops were injured or killed, the public has said our troops are dying in Afghanistan, what the heck are we doing there? We were spending millions on veterans' health care because of the injuries sustained, and our enemy was laughing at us because our enemy was attacking us at his strongest point, stealth, cheap, easy, you know, to do. Effective, and we were attacking him at our weakest point, the bang, when we have failure. So obviously, ladies and gentlemen, we had to rethink the whole thing. And over the next few years, NATO with the Allies built a network where we did biometrics, we took the perpetrators off the battlefield by using the scientific community on biometrics, we changed the Afghan legal system, or helped them so that they were able to prosecute successfully these people with evidence and so on, and change the laws to recognize this as a crime, which was not the case before. We worked with the customs, the private sector, the intelligence communities to identify the networks, the treasury departments to block the financing, the laboratories, and so on, so that we recognized who were the kingpins as opposed to the simple couriers. Did it solve the problem? Not entirely, but did it interrupt the supply chain in a major way that made the problem more manageable? Yes. So in other words, we turned around the equation. We attacked from our strongest point, the ability to network, to adopt a comprehensive approach, and we targeted our adversary's weakest point. It takes a network to defeat a network. And it's very important, as NATO goes forward, that it thinks, first of all, well, we got the right analysis. You know, are we going up the most productive face of Mount Everest here? Have we got the partnerships to achieve critical mass? Because only 20% of the threats and the challenges that NATO face in the 21st century will be the classical military type of threats. The great majority will be in this gray zone. Secondly, we need to catch up with the tech curve. One of the things I notice about NATO is that we discover issues late, often after the horse has bolted, when it comes to cyber or today space-based weapon systems. We're good at catching up, but it's clear, and I don't have much time to talk about this, but tech is really now dominating virtually everything we do, and it's going to define the way we live now. I can even see warfare being fought in the virtual reality space within the next 50 years or so, and the ability to understand tech, which goes faster. I mean, you know, think of the car. Or the airplane. They developed over 100 years before we recognized them as mature and safe technologies almost. The first car came out in 1880, but by 1960, the car was a mass transport vehicle, which was safe and regulated. So we had loads of time to think about technology, the public policy aspects, how to make it work. The iPhone has been out for 12 years, Facebook 15, and already, you know, we're into all of the security downsides and the public policy issues. Tech is coming faster than we're able to understand it and deal with it. And of course, the days when we did the tech and our adversaries stole it from us are over in terms of the investments that they are making. And This is now led by the private sector, which in artificial intelligence is investing five times more than Western governments in research and development. And therefore, one of the challenges for NATO is to get ahead of the tech curve much faster in terms of understanding it and knowing how to exploit it. And we need to do a better job here. I think NATO needs a tech laboratory at NATO headquarters and a science panel of advisors, which are constantly engaging the political level all the time. And this is what artificial intelligence is. You know, the latest experiment in quantum computing took place 2 weeks ago that validated the concept. We need to be in at this immediately before it becomes a major public policy issue. And we need to avoid a tech divide in NATO, where certain allies are comfortable with the new tech, like offensive cyber, have thought through the rules of engagement and the consequences and the use, and another group of allies are very reluctant, very hesitant, very conservative, very worried, and are very unhappy about these type of systems and how they could be used by allies on behalf of the alliance. So we need a much, much more focused approach to tech. We need more demanding exercising, both at the political and military level, to make sure that we really do ask ourselves the questions after exercise. It's not that it all went successfully and nothing bad happened and everybody's telephone answered everybody else's telephone, but how did we perform against demanding scenarios, demanding adversaries, real world things, and the ability to identify our weaknesses very candidly and recognize how we catch up. Another thing, of course, is that we're now going to be dealing with the sub-Article 5 level most of the time. But sub-Article 5 doesn't mean you can't respond. You know, you can't have a chemical attack in Salisbury and say, I'm not going to do anything. It wasn't a military invasion. And therefore, unless there's a military invasion, I don't have any options or any mandate to act. That would simply be inviting adversaries to repeat that kind of hybrid tactic. And frankly, one of the big challenges for NATO in the future is to go into a culture of regular decision-making. For most of my life at NATO, it was wonderful. You know, the worst never happened. Article 5 didn't need to be invoked. Deterrence worked. So in 70 years, we only needed to take very few big decisions. But today, we're in a hybrid area, every day, an ally will be coming saying, hey, I suffered a cyber attack last night. Or, you know, somebody interfered in my election campaign. Hey, somebody tried to use a chemical weapon. And therefore, I need to respond. And can we do attribution? Can we have a clear intelligence picture? Do we have an arsenal of measures below, let's send in the tanks, because we don't want to escalate here. We don't want to be the cause of the crisis. You know, what's the playbook of things that we can do which are going to respond adequately and enhance deterrence? Another thing, and I'm finishing in 1 minute, is that we need to marry also burden sharing to European defence. I think this is one of the greatest challenges over the next few years. The Europeans want their European strategic autonomy, or they talk about it. There's lots of things happening. For example, the new European Commission, instead of having €2.8 billion to spend on defence, will have €22.8 billion to spend on defence. Serious money. And if you agree with President Trump on 2%, you also have to agree that it doesn't make sense for the Europeans to spend a lot more money if most of it is wasted on duplication of programmes and R&D. It's like putting beer into a bottle while you drill holes in the bottom of the bottle and more comes out. So what we need to do, and I think this is going to be one of the greatest challenges, is to bring the transatlantic burden-sharing debate together with the European strategic autonomy in the alliance so that it supports both Europe's ability to act independently where NATO doesn't act and transatlantic solidarity. This is a difficult transatlantic debate. It depends, first of all, on Europeans being willing to do it, and that's not certain, and also to engage the United States that this is not simply about European protectionism or because we don't want to have the US involved. And then finally, ladies and gentlemen, we need to be more long-term. NATO is great at short-term. We're great at crisis management. You know, the pendulum of sweat of threats changes, you know, from terrorism to cyber to space to back to Russia. We're very good at that, re-engineering quickly to deal with the la crise du jour. We're not very good at sticking with long-term things. You know, partners in Central Asia, partners in the Asia Pacific, who seemed so important just a few years ago when it was all about Afghanistan. We act as if the old problems disappear simply because we now have a new trend or a new problem. So NATO is very good at crisis management, but in the 21st century, crisis management's not going to be enough. We need long-term strategies. We need to stick with things over several years, even when they're not on the front pages of the newspapers. NATO, looking at China recently, not with a view of doing anything, but at least with a view of keeping that on the radar screen, is, I think, at least an encouraging sign of the ability now to start doing some long-term thinking. But NATO cannot just concentrate on one threat. We live in a world of multiple threats, and anything that threatens the lives or the safety of NATO citizens must perforce be on the NATO agenda with a long-term strategy. So, how do I conclude? Well, the SecGen called me in a year ago on my last day at NATO headquarters and said, Jamie, I bet you're so glad to be leaving. You must be tired, fed up with NATO. You've been here for such a long time. Everybody calls you the dinosaur in residence. Even dinosaurs get to retire. You've had a fascinating time. You've lived through a lot of history, Jamie. You must be so glad you're going. And I honestly said, SecGen, no. Really, no. I wish I could have started today. I generally wish. He said, what? You must be crazy. It's all so complex. And I said, yes, Secretary General, because the next 70 years are going to be more demanding, much more demanding for NATO than the last 70 years. And we're not going to be lucky anymore. So because we're not going to be lucky, we're going to need NATO more in the next 70 years, arguably, than we even needed it in the last 70 years. And if we come through the next 70 years with all of these nasty things going on, still together, still secure, Europe and the United States and Canada, then we will deserve perhaps a 140th anniversary summit with even more pomp and ceremony, ladies and gentlemen, than we have had with this 70th anniversary summit. Thank you very much for listening. And again, thank you for inviting me today.